First Peter chapter 5 verse 10, but the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, settle you. Ladies and gentlemen, the Spirit of the Lord over the past couple weeks had me ministering to other people and letting them know that every situation that arises in our lives, we should not be shaken by. You know what time it is. Let's get it.
Heaven's above me, hell is beneath me. How in the world could these devils ever defeat me? Heaven's above me, hell is beneath me. How in the world could these devils ever defeat me? Heaven's above me, hell is beneath me. How in the world could these devils ever defeat me? Heaven's above me, hell is beneath me. How in the world could these devils ever defeat me?
Accepting the fact that my goal is the top, then knowing heaven is in that spot keeps driving me nonstop. Never allowing hell to defeat me. It's not possible as long as it's beneath me. Nothing sent from there could ever reach me.
What's going on, ladies and gentlemen? This is Apostle Macario coming to you all again. Over the past couple weeks, I know I've been gone for a couple weeks, but I've been busy doing ministry and different things. But it is very important that you all continue to watch the videos, like, subscribe, send the videos to other people. In doing so, that will free up, hopefully, in Jesus' name, more of my time that I can get a chance to consistently give you all videos every single day, right? That would be wonderful because there are so many revelations of God's word that I have yet to teach, not just you all, but anyone, because the Lord speaks to me consistently like that, and I'm always in his word. So there are revelations that I have from the time I first got saved that the Lord had me write down that I have yet to teach. So in doing so, by liking, subscribing to the channel, sending the videos out to other people, hopefully it will open up an avenue and the revenue that I can consistently give you all these revelations or teach every single day to inspire, to help you all continue to grow in God. But over the past couple weeks, as I was speaking to different people, there were situations that arose, including in my life, where the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me, and I'm not one easily shaken, so I kind of already knew this, but there were other people that have been Christians, living for God for some years, older than me especially, that I was ministering to, and the Lord had me ministering to them, telling them that every situation that arises in our lives, we should not be so easily shaken by. And many times there are so many people that are so easily shaken. It's like with every situation that arises that seems, you know, crazy, they get shaken by that. And at some point in life, at some point in time in your life, you should be so strong in God that regardless of what goes on, you are not moved by it, right? So I'm going to give you two what would seem like extreme cases in the Bible of people where a situation arose in their life. One of those cases, the person was not warned, and he was a prophet. He was not pre-warned that the situation was going to arise, and he was a prophet, and yet he wasn't moved by it because his faith was so strong and established in God that, and plus he knew who he was in God. That's one of the first things, know who you are in God. I taught you all, or I gave you all a message that I taught in the church probably back in 2013 or 14, know who you are. And that is so important. So if you go back in my videos somewhere back there in the long list of videos that I have, you will find that message. It's not an actual video. It's just the audio of the teaching, but you could hear what I taught to the church. And then there's another situation in the scriptures where the disciples were with Jesus, right? And the Bible says that the situation arose and Jesus was asleep. Right. So we have to get to the point where regardless of what happens in our lives, our faith is so strong in God that we are not shaken or moved by what we see, what happens on the outward. Not even what happens to your physical body. For some of you who don't yet have the faith of all that I've taught you about confessing the word of God over your life, and you'll be able to live affliction free in your body. But let's get into this. So, 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 10, I'm going to give you all the scripture again. It says, but the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. The Holy Spirit just brought another example to mind, and that's in the book of Job. But let's get into this really quickly. So I'm going to give you in 2 Kings chapter 4, and this is one of the verses that I was, or scriptures, that I was giving to the other people as they were speaking to me about their situations. I was telling them, look, and this is what I'm going to tell you as well. Look, these situations may catch you off guard, but they do not catch God off guard, right? And if you're in God, knowing that it doesn't catch God off guard, and if you know who you are in Christ Jesus, then you should not be shaken by every situation that arises. You shouldn't be stressing yourself out. You shouldn't be pulling your hair out. Your hair should not be falling out for most women and or men. But normally I found that that happens a lot more with women when they get stressed. Their hair will fall out a lot more. And they'll tell me about, you know, big globs of their hair basically falling out in the shower, and they're stressed out from this situation and that situation. But the more that you are strengthened, established, and settled in the faith, the less that these things will happen, to the point that they don't happen in every situation that arises, it doesn't move you. So we're going to go to 2 Kings chapter 4. I'm going to shorten the verses, but if you go and actually study that chapter, you'll understand the whole scenario of what happened. Long story short, a woman who was married, the prophet prophesied a child into her life. Her child died. Okay, this is making it short, summing it up for you, but I implore you in the name of Jesus that you go and study this for yourself. In the King James Version Bible only, no other version. But 2 Kings chapter 4, and we'll start at verse 22. It says, and she called unto her husband. Actually, we'll go up a little bit. We'll go up to 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 19. And he said unto his father, my head, my head. And he said to a lad, carry him to his mother. And when he was taken him and brought him to his mother, he sat on her knees till noon, and then he died. And she went up and laid him on the bed of the man of God, which was Elisha, and shut the door upon him and went out. And she called unto her husband and said, send me, I pray thee, one of the young men and one of the asses, that I may run to the man of God and come again. The only reason I didn't change that word, it means donkey, but the only reason I didn't change that word is because I don't believe in changing the word of God. God had to get me over that. Many years ago, I only used to say donkey. I didn't actually say the word in the King James Version. But as the Lord, and I already knew this revelation, told me, don't change his word. So I'm not going to change his word. So no, I did not curse. It's in the scripture in the King James Version, but it means a donkey, just so you know. And it says here in verse 23 of 2 Kings chapter 4, and he said, wherefore wilt thou go to him today? So basically he's saying, when will you go to him? Today, like right now? And it is neither new moon nor Sabbath. And she said, it shall be well, right? Verse 24, then she saddled an ass and said to her servant, drive and go forward, slack not thy riding for me, except I bid thee. So she said, go forward and don't slow down unless I tell you. She said, don't stop, don't slow down, don't do anything unless I tell you. And it says here in verse 25, so she went and came unto the man of God to Mount Carmel. And it came to pass, when the man of God saw her afar off, that he said to Gehazi, his servant, behold, yonder is the Shunammite. She was a Shunammite woman. Run now, I pray thee, to meet her and say unto her, is it well with thee? Is it well with thy husband? Is it well with the child? And she answered, it is well. And when she came to the man of God, to the hill, she caught him by the feet. But Gehazi came near to thrust her away, or push her away, or cast her off. And she and the man of God said, let her alone, for her soul is vexed within her, and the Lord hath hid it from me and hath not told me. Then she said, did I desire a son of my Lord? Did I not say, do not deceive me? Then he said to Gehazi, gird up thy loins and take my staff in thine hand and go thy way. If thou meet any man, salute him not. And if he salute thee, answer him not again. And lay my staff upon the face of the child. And the mother of the child said, As the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. And he arose and followed her. So there were a couple things here really quickly that you understand. Go back and study 2 Kings chapter 4. But he prophesied, once again, a child to this woman who was barren. She had the child. The child died. She ran to the man of God, right? So you all understand the progression of what happened. That's why she said in verse 28 of 2 Kings chapter 4, Then she said, Did I desire a son of my Lord? Did I not say, Do not deceive me, right? Because she was in mourning. She was grieving. She knew, like, her child died, and she was okay being, not necessarily okay being barren, but she had learned to cope with being barren and not having a child. Although in their society, if you're barren and don't have a child, they believe that you're cursed, right? At least back then, that was a part of what they believed was a curse. So God opened up her womb per the prophet that spoke into her life. So that's a whole other thing, ladies and gentlemen. Believe the Lord your God, so shall you be established. Believe his prophet, so shall you prosper. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 20. But it says here that he told her, he told Gehazi, go take my staff and lay it on the child's face. But she said, listen, she said, that's great and all, basically, and I'll put it in modern day English for you. She said, that's great and all, but she said, I'm not leaving here unless you come with me. And that's when it says here in 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 30, And the mother of the child said, As the Lord liveth and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. And he arose. Then Elisha arose and followed her. And it says in verse 31, And Gehazi passed on before them and laid the staff upon the face of the child. But there was neither voice nor hearing. Wherefore he went again to meet him and told him, saying, The child is not awaked. So Gehazi, Elisha's servant, came back and said, The child is not awake. He didn't come back to life. And when Elisha was come into the house, behold, the child was dead and laid upon his bed. And he went in therefore and shut the door and upon them twain and prayed unto the Lord. So Elisha and the child were the only two in the room. He shut the door behind them. And it says that he prayed unto the Lord. And he went up and laid upon the child and put his mouth upon his mouth and his eyes upon his eyes and his hands upon his hands. And he stretched himself upon the child and the flesh of the child waxed warm. So I want you to understand how great of a miracle this was. This means that the child's flesh was actually cold, which means rigor mortis had actually set in. The Spirit of the Lord has just given me this now as I'm talking to you by revelation, because I didn't think about this before, and as all the times I've studied this prior to, I don't think I've ever mentioned this to people when I preached it or ministered it to them. So this means that the child's flesh was already cold. That's why the Bible distinctly says that after he had done this, the flesh of the child waxed warm. So that means rigor mortis had set in. So the child was dead for some time now, right? And it says here in verse 35, Then he returned and walked in the house to and fro, and went up and stretched himself upon him. And the child sneezed seven times, and the child opened his eyes. And he said, and he called Gehazi and said, Call the Shunammite, this Shunammite. So he called her. And when she was come in unto him, he said, Take up thy son. Then she went in and fell at his feet and bowed herself to the ground and took up her son and went out. So what I want you to understand, ladies and gentlemen, is going back to verses 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 27, right? It says here in verse 27, And when she came to the man of God, to the hill, she caught him by the feet, but Gehazi came near to thrust her away. And the man of God, Elisha, said, Let her alone, for her soul is vexed within her, and the Lord hath hid it from me, and hath not told me. But one thing I want you to understand is because Elisha knew who he was. He knew he was a prophet of God. He knew he was a man of God. He was not swayed or moved or afraid based upon the woman being vexed. He did not even get moved after the woman said, "My child is dead." He basically knew when she said, "Did I ask you of a son? Didn't I tell you don't deceive me?" So Elisha knew that the child was dead. And she told him, anyway, you know, the child is dead. And so Elisha said, "Take my staff," because the anointing is transferable, just in case you all don't know and don't understand. It is transferable, not only in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, when it talks about the Apostle Paul and handkerchiefs and aprons being taken from the garments that he wore and sent out all across the place. And it says that demons came out of people, and people that were sick with all types of diseases were healed, right? So no matter what the disease was, the people were healed. And that was just from the garments. Now that is a double portion, or that is what Jesus meant when he said, I love you, Jesus. That is what Jesus meant when he said in John 14:12, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, the works that I do shall you do also, and greater works than these shall you do, because I go unto my Father," right? When Jesus was on the earth, the woman with the issue of blood came and touched the garment of Jesus, but the garment was still on Jesus. In the New Testament, "I love you, Jesus." When the Apostle Paul, when God wrought that special miracle through Paul, as the Bible says, it says that handkerchiefs and aprons were taken from the garments that were upon Paul and sent out, because the anointing was so heavy on Paul that they dwelled upon his garments, upon his clothes. And they were sent out, and it says that demons came out of people, and all that were possessed with diseases were healed. So that is what Jesus said when he talks about a double portion, or when Jesus said that greater works than these shall you do. I heard one foolish preacher say one time that the greater works was your love will be greater than Jesus. Excuse me, those of you that are not filled with the Spirit of God and relatively ignorant of the truth of the gospel. That's not what Jesus meant, because nobody's love could have been greater than Jesus. If you were perfect and you walked the earth and you never did evil, never sinned, never did any of that, and yet you knew you had to die on the cross for people, some of those people, which while you walked the earth did not believe, even though you were doing the miracle signs and wonders, they did not believe, and yet people were healed of all types of diseases. They got up, they were paralyzed, and God spoke, and they got up and began to walk. Some of them were paralyzed for 38 years, and Jesus said, "Take up your bed and go," and they went after 38 years. Nobody's love was greater than Jesus. So when people say that foolishness because they've been intellectualized, or they intellectualize the gospel, or they try to downplay the faith of the word of God, or they try to downplay the truth of the gospel, you are not teaching any truth. So the miracle signs and wonders don't manifest in your church because you're not teaching truth. You cannot intellectualize the gospel. You cannot make theology greater than the word of God, or the faith of God, or the fact that God can do all things. You cannot make what you've learned in cemetery school — I call it cemetery, you call it seminary — you cannot make what you've learned in college or cemetery school more potent or stronger than the word of God and the faith of God. So no, the greater works is not your love will be greater than Jesus, because that's impossible. Foolish one. What will be greater is your faith, or not greater than Jesus' faith, but what can be greater is that you can grow in faith to do what Jesus did and the greater works as he spoke that to us in his word. So once again, going back, I didn't forget where I was, going back to where we were, the anointing can be and is transferable. It can be placed on something or in something to bring people back to life or to heal them of their diseases, etc. That's why Elisha, even in the Old Testament, knew, take the staff and go lay it upon the face of the child. That's why he said that. But then the Shunammite woman said, "Listen, I'm not going to leave unless you come with me." Because she knew the staff is cool. That's great. And she's like, "I know that the anointing may be there, because it is attached to you as a part of you, as something that you carry around." But nevertheless, she was like, "I'm not leaving unless you come." Sometimes you have to understand what level of faith you need to see your miracle occur. She knew that Elisha, she was standing there when Elisha sent his servant. Elisha sent his servant. Elisha sent the staff. And she said, yeah, no, I'm not leaving unless you come. That's what she said. I'm not leaving unless you come, man of God. I'm not going unless you go with me. Right? So, and you could go to the Old Testament and even study about that in another part of the Old Testament in the book of Judges. Where he said, listen, Deborah, I'm not going up unless you come. Because I want the presence of God with us. Judges chapter 4, verse 8. And Barak said unto her, if thou wilt go with me, then I will go. But if thou wilt not go with me, then I will not go. So, ladies and gentlemen, the word of God, as I told you all before, repetition is the father of learning. God speaks the same thing to us over and over in the Bible. And unless we study the word and we know the word of God, no, we're intimate with Jesus Christ. We're intimate with the word of God. We're intimate with God. These things won't come back to your remembrance without the Holy Spirit, without you being intimate with God and knowing what God is saying. So the anointing was transferable and is transferable, but she said, I want you to come, man of God. I want you to show up because I know the Spirit of God is with you. And even after he came, it says he stretched himself upon the child and the child waxed warm. But then it says, if you all understand spiritually, it says that he went in the house and walked back and forth because the anointing is also expandable. And I teach this to people and sometimes people don't get it, but I've taken you all through scriptures through my YouTube channel many a times and talked about this as well, that the anointing is expansive. The anointing is not limited. So the anointing is expandable, but yet and still he knew what may have been in the house. The spirit of death may have been there. So he went down, walked in the house back and forth. Obviously he was in prayer, though the Bible doesn't mention that. He was in prayer, walked back and forth in the house, went back up, and the child came back to life. So there are a lot of things attached to this that I'm teaching you all and the scriptures that I'm giving you all that you can go and study for yourself. But this is why I tell you to study the word of God. Get in the Bible and let the word of God be life unto you. Come to know Jesus. Don't spend time studying man-made books. Study the word of God, the King James Version, and get intimate with God. Get out of the TV. Get out of the radio. Of course, you still may want to praise and worship. Let God speak that to you. But get out of the TV, get out of the internet, get out of the radio. Spend quiet time with God and seek God's face, okay? Because then God can really manifest his glory in your life. And of course, you have to be holy. But if you're seeking God's face, God will teach you that you have to be holy. And you should know that anyway if you've been following my channel at all at any point in time in this time that I've been doing YouTube. So the idea and the understanding of this scripture is that Elisha was not shaken by the death of the child. He knew who he was, and even though God did not reveal it to him, and he was a prophet and very deep prophet, very anointed, just like Elijah was, who was his mentor, all of this happened, and yet he was not moved, right? And this is what you all have to understand. All of this could happen, and you have to be so rooted and grounded in God and your faith unshaken and unshakable that regardless of what happens, you're not going anywhere. You're not turning your back on God. Same thing with Job. If you go to Job, it says that all that happened with Job, it says through all that happened, Job did not, let me go here. Thank you, Jesus. Okay. I'm just going to read the one verse to you because I want you all to get it. Job chapter 1, three verses. Chapter 1, verse 20 through 22. Then Job arose and rent his mantle and shaved his head and fell down upon the ground and worshipped after all that happened to him and said, naked came I out of my mother's womb and naked shall I return thither. The Lord gave and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Verse 22. In all this Job sinned not nor charged God foolishly. After he had lost his cattle, his sheep, his children, his house, all that he lost, the Bible says he still didn't sin and charge God foolishly. And then God allowed Satan to afflict Job's flesh. And in all that, Job still did not sin nor charge God foolishly. And because Job was perfect before God, which he mentioned, and that's where I'm trying to get you guys back to, is perfection in God. And that's why I read the scripture I read to you in 1 Peter, because if you listen to what I told you, and I know a lot of churches teach against it because they're ignorant and they don't know the Word of God, nor are they studying the King James Version, nor have they been intimate with God. You can be perfect with God. I've taught you all about that before. Go into the teaching, and the teaching is a 7 or 8 part series, Perfect with God. You can look it up. But it says here in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 10 again, But the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, is the first thing that it says. Establish, strengthen, settle you. Right? Make you perfect, establish, strengthen, settle. So I'm trying to get you all to the place where your faith is unshakable, regardless of what happens. You do not charge God foolishly. You do not speak dumb things out of your mouth that are ungodly, that can limit or hinder your miracle, your blessing from coming to pass. But the last verse I'm going to give you, or the last couple verses, the last situation, is Jesus with the disciples. And it says here in Matthew chapter 8, verse 23, and when he was entered into a ship, his disciples followed him. And behold, there arose a great tempest in the sea, or storm, insomuch that the ship was covered with the waves, but he was asleep. Right? So the storm is going on. Jesus is in the ship, on the boat. The storm is going on. The tempest, the waves are, the water is in the ship. And it says here that Jesus was asleep. And it says in verse 25, and his disciples came to him and awoke him, saying, Lord, save us, we perish. Lord, save us, we're going to die. Jesus got up in verse 26, and he saith unto them, why are ye fearful, O ye of what? Little faith. Then he arose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. But the men marveled, saying, what manner of man is this, that even the winds and the sea obey him? Ladies and gentlemen, I'm telling you from experience, not teaching you something I have not already experienced. People in my family, including my mother and others, are a witness. And I was sitting in this men's meeting of people that think that they're elders in God. They've been, quote unquote, saved for a long time. And many of them are from different denominations. And one of the gentlemen brought up a story about a gentleman that was in Africa, and he was doing a revival, and witches and warlocks before he got there said, we're going to stop this revival. So they did some witchcraft, and a storm came over the revival, and it was raining. And the man of God that was preaching knew that it was of Satan and not of God, because it came out of nowhere. And so he told the people to start praying, and they said within minutes the storm stopped and it cleared back up. Well, to these men that have been in God for, quote unquote, some time, that was something that was amazing to them, right? And he read this from this book. To me, that's, and I didn't say anything to them because I try not to do this, but to me, I was like, that's not anything that's not common to people that walk in the supernatural. I've done that multiple times in my lifetime from the time I first got saved, because my faith is built up and I know the Word of God, and you stay in prayer. So this is why I tell you guys to get out of other people's books and get in the King James Version of the Bible and study and spend time with God and pray. Stopping it from raining or rebuking a storm is not something that is uncommon to those who believe the Word of God and walk in the supernatural. That's something that's like, it's just common. And it just amazes me that people claim to be Christians and they supposedly have studied the Word of God. Like, I've studied the Bible, and well, not to the extent, because a lot of them, when I think I asked that question before, how many of them have read the Bible from cover to cover, and they've been saved for 30 or 40 years, quote unquote, and they haven't done it. So it's like, well, that's why your faith is not where it needs to be. That's why you're not seeing the supernatural. You're not spending time with God. And so, you know, for them, it was a big thing. He prayed and he stopped the storm because the witches sent a storm out in the warlocks. And I'm like, that's not, it's common, ladies and gentlemen. That's what I'm trying to get you to understand. I'm trying to get your faith to that level where you're not shaken. It's common. there are people that have been around me that know that for me, that's common. That's not something that's out of the, it's crazy. Listen, Old Testament, just so you all understand, Jesus rebuked the winds and the waves in this, and the Bible says in verse 26, and he saith unto them, why are you fearful, ye of little faith? Obviously, that applies to the men that I'm telling you about that are all older than me. Men of little faith, right? Because if you don't know the word of God, you have little faith. So it's super, it's crazy to you. And it's like amazing when you have faith and you know the word of God, it's like normal for us that truly live holy and walk right. And, you know, so it says here, Jesus said unto them, why are you so fearful, ye of little faith? Then he arose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus only did what the prophets did. Elijah prophesied, and 3.5 years, the Bible says, in James chapter 5, it didn't rain upon the earth. Not one city, and I taught you all about this before. It was not just one city. It didn't rain upon the earth. Jesus, they woke Jesus up out of his sleep because he was not shaken by the storm, which we need to be the same way. If we're supposed to be like Jesus, we ought to know this. He was not shaken by the storm. They woke Jesus up, and Jesus was not moved, and Jesus was like, why are you afraid, you of little faith? And he rebuked the winds and the sea. And the Bible says there was great calm. Not just calm, there was great calm. But Jesus did that, and the apostle, but the prophet Elijah already had stopped it from raining 3.5 years. And these men should have known this, right? They should have known this. And it should not have been something so crazy and so great. But the problem is when you don't know who you are and you don't understand the word of God and you're not spending your time seeking God's face and in his word and praying without ceasing, which that's something you can do and get to. All of these things seem miraculous. But I'm looking, I was sitting there in this meeting with these men and I'm like, you all are all older than me. And to you guys, that's amazing. To me, it's already happened since I was 21, 22, 23 years old. And it's happened more than once. It's just because I have faith in God. And that's how we should be, ladies and gentlemen. It's not, we should not, that's what I'm trying to get across to you. Every situation that arises in your life should not make your faith waver. It should not make you stray from God. Every, whether it be a bill or a debt, or whether it be a illness in a family member, because it doesn't have to happen to you, whether it be someone dying unexpectedly, you know, that shouldn't move your faith. That shouldn't make you stop seeking God. That shouldn't make you change your faith. And the more that you quote scripture over your life, and the more that situations happen in your life and you know the word of God, the more that you confess the word of God over the situation. And then you'll see God show up miraculously. Or you'll see God do something great on your behalf. Every situation that arises should not shake you. That's why it says, and I go back to this verse again, and I'm going to give you guys one last verse after this. But that's why it says there in 1 Peter chapter 5. Oh my gosh. I'm so bubbling over. That's why it says in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 10, but the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. That means God wants to root and ground you in him, in his word, in the word of God, in faith, in life. But he can't do that if every situation that arises, you forget about him just that quickly. Just like the children of Israel. Every situation that arose that they felt like they were going to die or they were going to hunger or thirst, or every situation that arose with the children of Israel, they wavered in their faith. Even though they were with Moses when he went up to the mount, they heard God's voice. They saw God speak to Moses. They knew that God had used Moses to deliver them. Every situation that arose, they wavered in faith. They were stressed out. They were complaining. They were murmuring. And that's why God killed them off. The Bible talks about it. Everything that happened, they murmured and complained. They didn't confess the word of God. They didn't say, God brought us through this. He'll bring us through this also. Every situation that arose, they murmured, they complained, they confessed the situation and not the word of God. They didn't rehearse what God had already done for them. Every situation, every single time. And God was like, you know what? I got to kill off this generation. And if I told you all what God spoke to me the past couple days about what he's going to do in 2019, we're going to see a lot of that. A lot of elders that, or people that claim to be elders in the faith, are going to die off in 2019. And I'm speaking it to you now because I know the Lord spoke it to me prophetically. A lot of the old time people, some of them are true saints of God that are truly established. Some of them, a majority of them though, in 2019, are going to be people that claimed Christianity that were not living it. They wavered and murmured and complained every single time a situation arose. You're going to see that. And if you don't believe me, understand, I prophesied to you all in 2016 about pastors dying in 2017. And in January of 2017, I think it was two pastors I had heard of that I knew. One was a big name preacher on TV, ended up dying a couple days in. Another one, a church out here in Michigan, ended up dying. And then another one that I knew ended up dying. And probably a whole lot more, but it was unexpected for most people. But for me, I had already prophesied it to you all. So it wasn't unexpected to me. So I'm telling you all this in 2019, and I'm prophesying it now. Now, this is still December 19th, I believe it is, of 2018. In 2019, you're going to see a lot of elders in the church die off. Okay? Or some of them, once again, are people of God. But majority of them that are going to die off are people that had no faith in God. They played the role, but God is like, no, because I need this next generation. The Lord is saying, because I need this next generation to operate in greater power. So if the elders prior to, like the children of Israel, for 40 years God was dealing with them and they didn't grow any. 40 years God is walking them around and they have not grown in faith after God had done all of this before them. And God says, okay, I need to kill off this generation that the younger people don't pick up these ungodly, ignorant, and foolish habits or this theology or this doctrine that is not of me. So God said in 2019, he's doing the same thing. Listen to me well. God is about to kill off an older generation because from what's coming on the earth, God needs a younger generation that is more on fire and has more faith and belief in him to arise, to conquer and do what he called them to do before this world, the time is over, before the true tribulation comes to pass or the rest of the tribulation comes to pass. That's why God had to kill off the elders in Israel, of the children of Israel. And he used Caleb and Joshua to bring them into the destiny that God had actually called them to. Which they were the younger ones because the older ones were not getting it. And God said, okay, I'm done dealing with you all. I'm done letting you deceive my people. I'm finished having you go out and not believe in me after all that you've seen me do. That's the thing. They've seen God do things and they still choose to waver and not do right by God. And that's when God gets grieved in the spirit. So God had to remove that generation. But ladies and gentlemen, that's what the scripture says here. And then there's another scripture that the Spirit of the Lord brought to me right here in Hebrews chapter 13. And I'll read to you verses 20 and 21. Now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect, there's that word again, in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Keep in mind, look at what the word just said after I just gave to you. Now, this is something God just gave me right before I got on here. The Lord had me glance across that scripture. But look at what it says in Hebrews 13, verse 21. Make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. So he said, make you perfect to do his will. The children of Israel in the Old Testament were not doing the will of God because they should not have had to go around 40 years in the wilderness. So they weren't doing his will. That's the first thing. The second thing that scripture says is working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. When you're not doing his will, you're not pleasing, well-pleasing to God in his sight. And it says, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. So the other scenario I just gave you about the children of Israel, they were not doing his will. They were not well-pleasing in his sight. So God said, I have to kill off this generation in order to let this next generation do my will and do what is well-pleasing in my sight. So ladies and gentlemen, I said all of that, and look what it says again. It says, make you perfect. That's how it starts, verse 21. Make you perfect. So everything that I've been teaching you all since the Lord gave me that revelation, ladies and gentlemen, over the past 7 or 8 years, and the Lord gave me that revelation well before I got on YouTube about perfection in him, everything I've been teaching you all is to help bring you back to that place of perfection in God when we were in the Garden of Eden, when God was able to walk and talk with us. There was no sin in us, and we were perfect before God, right? And if you don't understand that, that's what Jesus came for as well. And I'm going to give you another scripture, because if we're supposed to be like Jesus, and people miss this, and that's why I teach you all about this perfection thing, but this message was to say, stop being so easily shaken and moved by every situation that arises in your life. Stop it. Get yourself established, strengthened, and settled in the Word of God, and in faith, and in prayer, and in studying, and in fasting, and praying. That way, you are not moved by every single situation that arises. Let me give you this about Jesus when it comes to perfection. He mentioned this also because this was Jesus. In John chapter 14, verse 30. Actually, John chapter 14, verse, we'll start at verse 26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things, he shall teach you all things, and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither be let it be afraid. Ye have heard, so once again, Jesus said peace. When you have peace, you're not shaken by every situation, ladies and gentlemen. When you have peace with God and the peace that Jesus left, every situation that arises is not going to move you. It's not going to sway your faith. You're not going to be stressed out losing hair, crying and complaining and murmuring. Peace, the peace of God. Verse 28, ye have heard now, I said unto you, I go away and come again unto you. If ye love me, you would rejoice. But I said, I go unto the Father, for my Father is greater than I. Verse 29, and now I have told you before it come to pass, that when it come to pass, ye might believe. So once again, what I just prophesied to you about the elders being dying off in the church because God is moving this next generation, I've told you in advance. Because the Holy Spirit told me in advance. And I'm telling you before it happens in 2019, so you're not easily moved and shaken. So when it happens, don't do all that murmuring and complaining and all that throwing up and giving up on God stuff. You've been told already in advance. Okay, verse 29, one more time. And now I have told you before it come to pass, that when it come to pass, ye might believe. Hereafter, I will not talk much with you, for the prince of this world cometh and hath nothing in me. Verse 31, but that the world may know that I love the Father, and as the Father gave me commandment, even so I do. Arise, let us go hence. But the key verse is John 14, 30. Hereafter I will not talk much with you, for the prince of the world of this world cometh and hath nothing in me. So going back to what I was telling you in Genesis, before the fall of man, we were perfect. Satan came and he could find nothing in them. So he had to deceive Eve, who in turn gave to Adam, deceive them to disobey God, because Satan knew that they were perfect. God was still walking and talking with them without any hindrance and any interference. They had no sickness, nor affliction, nor disease in their body. We were perfect. So everything I'm teaching you is to help you get back to that place, as the Bible says, to make you perfect, to establish, to strengthen, to settle you, to make you perfect in God so you can perform the miracle signs and wonders that he wants us to do in the earth. But until you really desire to walk with God and establish that connection with God and to do what God has called you to, ladies and gentlemen, you won't be perfect with God. I'm teaching you to get perfect with God. And the reason I'm teaching it to you is because I've been there and I'm getting back there. I'm not teaching you from inexperience or just reading it and not being intimate with Jesus and God the Father. When God taught me that revelation, and I told you all this before, when God gave me the revelation on perfection, even though in the churches I've been growing up hearing it for years and it was a lie that we can never be perfect with God, when God gave me that revelation, he had already spoken to me in the spirit that I was perfect with him. I knew his voice. I know his voice. God had already said, when he showed it to me in the scripture, I remember this so vividly. I was laying in the bed studying the word, and my mother could tell you I was studying the word for 4 or 5 hours after I woke up. I wouldn't do anything. I would not eat. I was studying the word. And she would have to tell me, get up, it's daytime. We were living on Miami Beach. I was studying the word, and the Lord had me run across a scripture that talked about perfection. And when I studied it, I said, Lord, what are you saying here? Because everything that they've taught based upon their theology and their lies has been, you can never be perfect with God. And that's when the Lord opened up that revelation to me, because I would meditate on his word. And God told me, after I read that first verse, before I went into other verses that the Holy Spirit brought to my remembrance, the Lord said, you're perfect with me. When the Lord told me that, and after I had studied that scripture, and I didn't go to my concordance, and I didn't go to any of these other books, because the word of God was in me so deeply that I already knew where other places in the Bible were where it talked about perfection. So when God told me that by his spirit, God is my witness, and gave me that revelation, that's why I constantly teach on it, and the Lord told me that I was perfect with him, it blew my mind. And that's what the word of God should do, because that's how deep and wide and vast and holy and pure and righteous and amazing and awesome God is, where you stop putting limits on God. And then God had me teach on perfection, and I could not do it to a lot of people because they weren't there. Even Jesus, when Jesus was walking with the disciples, he said, listen, I can't tell you everything, because right now you're not even able to bear a lot of what I want to tell you. But what Jesus did do is show them a ton of miracle signs and wonders. And the Bible talks about that as well, that the Bible says if we were to try to write books based upon all that Jesus had done, and I'll give it to you, and it's in John chapter 21, verse 25. And it says here, actually 24 and 25, this is the disciple which testifieth of these things and wrote these things, and we know that his testimony is true, the testimony of Jesus Christ. And there are also many other things which Jesus did, the which, if they should be written, every one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that should be written. Amen. So Jesus told the disciples, listen, I can't tell you everything, but what I can do while I'm here is I can show you. And as Jesus began to show them, John said in the four Gospels, in John chapter 21, verse 25, that if we were to write all that Jesus had done, the world itself could not contain the books. That's what John said. The world itself cannot contain the books. So some of the things that, like I told you all in the beginning of this video, there are revelations that God has given me that I have yet to teach people. I have yet to teach people, because they are not, and I'm talking about revelations from over 10 years ago, ladies and gentlemen, because they're not able to bear some of the little bit that I'm teaching right now. let alone the testimonies that I try to tell people that God has used me to do, that people have been witness to. So I'm trying to build your faith to get you to the place of understanding that God is greater than your theology, or greater than what you think you know based upon what you've been told by men who really don't have manifestations of his glory, or that go out and look for the history without knowing the Bible front to back, and allowing God and the Holy Spirit and Jesus Christ to bring to their remembrance all that God had said to them in the scriptures alone. And that's why so many of them try to teach the gospel and the manifestation of God's glory never occurs. And I'm going to teach on this next. I was also dealing with some people that said they were tired of hearing the word. They want people to live it. And I had to explain to a gentleman, and I'm teaching, I'm going to do a video on this probably next week. But I was grieved because I said to myself, how could you be tired of hearing the word when you don't even know it? They think that they know the word because they've been sitting in church. But in the churches that they sit in, there are no manifestations of God's glory during the service. So you don't know the word, and then there are no manifestations in their own life. Like, okay, you prophesy a little. And it's like a general prophecy. It's not directly to someone. So you can't say you know the word until the word becomes a part of you and alive and you're operating. That's when you know the word. Because you went to theology school or you sat in church for 30, 40 years, that doesn't mean you know the word. You don't know the word until it becomes a part of you and you start to operate and manifest the glory of God. Because when you say you're tired of hearing the word, that means you're tired of hearing Jesus. And if you're tired of hearing Jesus, you definitely don't know the word. Because everywhere Jesus went, he manifested the glory and the power of God. So if you know the word and you've been intimate with Jesus, you're going to manifest what Jesus manifested in some shape, form, or fashion. Then you know the word. And when you say that, then you would never say you're tired of hearing the word, you want people to live it, because first you would be living it. And then secondly, not only would you be living it, you would be manifesting his glory. And the more revelation and the more manifestation, the less you would say, I'm tired of hearing the word and I want people to live it, because you're living it. So the more that God shows up in your life, there's no way you would say, I'm tired of hearing the word. So I'm going to teach on that next. But ladies and gentlemen, this video was about you understanding that there is no possible way that every situation that arises in your life, you should be shaken by. So I love you all. I will see you all again soon. I pray that you get this. If you don't know Jesus, you need to come to know him as your Lord and Savior. And you need to renounce, denounce, give up all of those things that are contrary to the word of God. Go back and watch these videos of 8 years worth of teaching that you have been getting, going on 8 years, if not 8 years already, that you have been getting of the word of God to build your faith. Get in the word of God. Study fast. Study the King James Version of the Bible only. Fast. Pray. Study, fast, and pray. Separate yourself before the Lord and give God his time. And watch how God will show up and manifest his glory in your life. I love you all. I will see you all again soon. May God bless. Get to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. If you don't know Jesus, you can repeat with me. Father God, I come before you humbly, asking you to forgive me of all of my sins. Sins that I know of and sins I know not of. Lord God, I repent of my sins. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Be Lord and Savior over my life. Lord God, I believe that Jesus Christ walked the earth and did many mighty miracles, signs, and wonders. Lord Jesus, I believe that you were perfect from birth until death. Died on the cross for my sins to reconcile me to God. Come into my heart. Be Lord and Savior over my life. Holy Spirit, please lead and guide me in the way that is true according to the word of God. Reveal to me all that God desires for me to know, that I may live this life and be well-pleasing and obedient unto God our Father. I thank you that I am now accepted in the body of believers. I am a saint, and that my sins have been washed away, and I am healed and whole. In Jesus' name I pray, Amen. Welcome, welcome, welcome into the kingdom of God, into the kingdom of heaven, into the body of believers, into the fellowship of the saints. Don't take it lightly if you just confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. The Bible says in Luke 15:10, likewise I say unto you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth. So if you were just that one sinner that just repented, angels are rejoicing in heaven with you right now. I love you all. I love you. I love you. You have no idea how much I love you. I will see you all again soon. May God bless. We are out.
Heaven's above me. Hell is beneath me. How in the world could these devils ever defeat me? Heaven's above me. Hell is beneath me. How in the world could these devils ever defeat me? Heaven's above me. Hell is beneath me. How in the world could these devils ever defeat me? Heaven's above me. Hell is beneath me. How in the world could these devils ever defeat me?
Accepting the fact that my goal is the top, then knowing heaven is in that spot, keeps driving me nonstop. Never allowing hell to defeat me. It's not possible as long as it's beneath me. Nothing sent from there could ever reach me.